Father, we thank you. Thank you, thank you, thank you, Lord. From the bottom of our hearts, Lord, that you led us tonight to come together, Lord, here to worship you, to the studying of your word. Lord, we thank you for giving us a beautiful day, Lord. And Father, whatever we had to deal with today, Lord, we know first and foremost you were in it, you were with it. And often we just have to ask or to invite you more into our affairs. But Lord, you had grace and mercy upon us, our lives, our family members, Lord. And we thank you so much for the love of your Son for us, Lord. And thank you, Father, that you have given us enough desire at the end of the day, Lord, and enough energy to come together, Lord, to study your word and to worship you through it. We thank you, Father, for all the blessings that you continuously pour upon our lives, Lord. We thank you, Father, that we know we're not worthy of any of them. But Lord, it is your grace and your mercy, again, the love for humanity, for fallen humanity, Lord, and redeemed humanity, Lord, that you just keep on pushing us down that narrow road, Lord, and helping us, Lord, to run our race with perseverance. So Lord, tonight, as we open your word again, give us ears to hear, give us hearts to understand. May the manna from heaven that is coming through us, through your word, Lord, fall on fertile ground, Lord, and increasing not only our knowledge of you, of your Son Jesus, but Father, that it also is keeping us closer and closer to you, Lord, that our lives may be the witnesses that you designed us and created us to be, that we would not stray from any kind of work that you bring towards us in regards to spreading the good news, giving that what has been given freely to us, to others, Lord, and even in these times, Lord, as we see the dark clouds are hovering above us, Lord, that we will not fail to be the light and the salt, Lord, that you want us to be and actually command us to be. So, Father, we thank you, Lord. May our hearts now be lifted up to your very throne room as we sing. Father, and then as we go into your word, Lord, again, we ask you to give us ears to hear, hearts to understand, break everything down, Lord, that our lives may be changed and that we may walk out of here better than as we walked in. So we thank you, Father. We give you now all the praise and the glory in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
Well, as you guys can see, going back through a few of the hymns that we've sang already, just to get everybody familiar with them, and you guys are familiar with this one for sure. Amazing Grace, 1779. In him we have redemption through his blood, the forgiveness of sins, according to the riches of his grace. Ephesians 1:7. It's hard to shake off a mother's influence. John Newton's earliest memories were of his godly mother, who, despite fragile health, devoted herself to nurturing his soul. At her knee, he memorized Bible passages and hymns. Though she died when he was about 7, he later recalled her tearful prayers for him. After her death, John alternated between boarding school and the high seas, wanting to live a good life, but nonetheless falling deeper and deeper into sin. Pressing into service with the British Navy, he deserted, was captured, and after 2 days of suspense, was flogged. His subsequent thoughts vacillated between murder and suicide. I was capable of anything, he recalled. More voyages, dangers, toils, and snares followed. It was a life unrivaled in fiction. Then, on the night of March 9th, 1748, John, 23, was jolted awake by a brutal storm that descended too suddenly for the crew to foresee. The next day, in great peril, he cried to the Lord. He later wrote, "That 10th of March is a day much remembered by me, and I have never suffered it to pass unnoticed since the year 1748. The Lord came from on high and delivered me out of deep waters." The next several years saw slow, halting spiritual growth as John, but in the end, he became one of the most powerful evangelical preachers in British history, a powerful foe of slavery, and the author of hundreds of hymns. Here are some things you may not know about Newton's most famous hymn. His title, for it wasn't originally Amazing Grace, but Faith's Review and Expectation. It is based on Newton's study of 1 Chronicles 17, 16 through 17. King David said, "Who am I, O Lord God, and what is my house that you have brought me this far? And yet, you have also spoken of your servant's house for a great while to come, and have regarded me according to the rank of a man of high degree." And here's a nearly forgotten verse that Newton added near the end of Amazing Grace. "The earth shall dissolve like snow, the sun forbear to shine, but God, who called me here below, shall be forever mine." Okay, let's go ahead and stand. And it will be verse 1, 2, and 4, and then 1 again.
Sweet the sound that saved us. was blind, but now I see.
Amen. Amen to that. Oh boy. You got the compressed version. All right, we will continue after a little side trip. Last week in Matthew 27:51. All the way through 66, which is the end of 27. I told you, by the time we get Matthew done, the Lord is coming back, man. We left off in 27:51a, so the first part of 51, last time with the veil being torn from top to bottom. And we had last week the brief summary about the tabernacle, basically the tabernacle set up, the first, second temple, and we revealed the mystery behind the torn veil at the very moment that Jesus was crucified and yielding up his spirit. Spurgeon said about the fact that the veil was rent, and I quote, "It is not a slight rent through which we may see a little, but it is rent from the top to the bottom. There's an entrance made for the greatest sinners. If there had only been a small hole cut through it, the lesser offenders might have crept through. But what an act of abounding mercy is this, that the veil is rent in the midst and rent from top to bottom, so that the chief of sinners may find ample passage." That's where we left off last week. And so, in the days of the early church, a great many priests were obedient to the faith, it says in Acts 6:7. It means a lot of these priests, they were very familiar with the temple worship and all these things that had to do with it, came to Christ. They were saved. Perhaps this torn veil demonstrated to them the greatness of the work of Christ. And it's possible, or possibly the reason how the torn veil became common knowledge. And now we all can say and believe and stand on the promise of the writer of Hebrews, where it says in Hebrews 4:14 through 16, and I read it to you. "Seeing then that we have a great high priest who has passed through the heavens, Jesus, the Son of God, let us hold fast our confession. For we do not serve a high priest who cannot sympathize with our weaknesses, but was in all points tempted as we are, yet without sin. Let us therefore come boldly to the throne of grace, that we may obtain mercy and find grace to help in time of need." No more veil. We can march right into the very throne room of heaven, to God's throne room, because of that act on Calvary and what Jesus accomplished for us. And to that we can say, hallelujah, hallelujah, amen. And by the word hallelujah or alleluia, it is hallelujah, Yahweh. That's where it came from. praise be to God, or praise be to Yahweh, or praise ye Yahweh. So it's not hallelujah me, it's hallelujah Yahweh, because some people, that's how they walk through life. So, boy. Anyways, so Matthew 27 and the second part of 51. So behold, the veil was torn in two, and from the top to the bottom, and the earth quaked and the rocks were split. And again, Spurgeon said, men's heart did not respond to the agonizing cries of the dying Redeemer, but the rocks responded. The rocks were rent, not the human heart. Christ did not die for rocks, yet rocks were more tender than the hearts of men for whom he had shed his blood. And we see in this time we live in the absolute satanic idiocy of those organizations and those people, whether it's Greenpeace movement and so many other of these guys, that out there, they save the trees, save the whales, save the bugs, whatever it might be, and the list goes on. But if you take an egg of a bald eagle and you're caught by the authorities with egg in hand, you have to pay $250,000 and 2 years in prison. But to kill millions of human life, of innocent babies, which are made in the image of God, there's no penalty. In fact, they get rewarded by big checks for the procedures they are doing and the body parts they are selling. It's all backwards. The left and their satanic helpers are whining every day about the number of COVID-19 people that died. And it's not, we all know, it's not even anything in comparison to a regular flu anyways. And they're lying through their teeth so they can kill hundreds of thousands of innocent life more. And I just hope that, hope and pray that we, as God's shield here on earth, that his light and his salt, that we just don't come before the Lord on a daily basis to dump our laundry list before him. Because when the hammer of God comes down, whenever that might be, individually for each and every one of us at one point in time, or corporately in the rapture, regardless, we have the greater accountability towards all these things. God never put his fingers, if you go back in the Old Testament, he put his fingers on these people that were sinners too, sooner or later. But first and foremost, he puts his fingers on those that should have known better, that knew the scripture, that said they were Christians, that prayed, that took the name of God and said, I am a Christian, I am a little Christ, Christ-like. And if we're caught, that basically we only were a Christian on the outside, so we know better than any of the hypocrites that we read about or that we come across every single day. And so I hope and pray that we will not fail to stand in the gap and intercede, not only for those unborn children, but also for those evildoers and all these other things that are happening that you see right now unfolding everywhere. It's nothing new under the sun. We know that. Solomon said it. It's written down. All these things have been before. Ahab and Jezebel were doing the same thing. They were actually, it was her religion, if you will, that actually brought even a greater attention to the child sacrifice back in their days. And then, of course, the Lord took Jehu to wipe them out and put things right again. But it's not for us to wait for anybody, because we know the Lord has given us everything we need to do the right thing, to do His work. And part of that is just to be in constant intercession, in constant prayer, and in constant standing in the gap, and using the weaponry that the Lord has given us to its fullest extent. So back to Matthew. So the earth shook when God gave the law, if you remember that, to Moses on Mount Sinai in Exodus 19:18, chapter 19, verse 18. The earth shook because the law was meant to shake people up. The Lord said back to these people then in their days, you think you're righteous? You think you're okay? Let's see how you match up to the Ten Commandments. Paul later wrote in Galatians 3:24 that the law was given to us as a schoolmaster to make us see that we are sinners in need of a Savior. But here, as the Lord is crucified or was crucified, the very moment, the very point in time, the earth is shaking again, but this time not to shake people up, but to shake men loose. Loose from the law. Because now we're not under the law anymore, but we're under grace. We're no longer under the law, but we are free. The price has been paid. The veil is rent. It is finished. Tetelestai. That's what the Lord said. And so I hope when we read the word, it continuously shakes it up and shakes us loose and reminds us what we're here for. Not to titillate our own little, you know, feelings and everything else, which is nice and dandy. The Lord knows already about that. But always remember, Matthew 6:33, seek ye first the kingdom of God and His righteousness, and all these other things will be added unto you. So whatever we have to deal with, first of all, the Lord is not surprised anything that happens in our life when it happens. He already knew about it. So all we have to do is to invite Him, to make Him part of whatever we go through, but leave this aside. Let the Lord deal with that. We deal with what the Lord gives us by the Spirit through prayer. We stand the gap. We come alongside other believers, people that are struggling, people that are slowing down in the race that is set before us. That is what our job is. And so the earth shook. In verse 52 says then, and the graves were opened, and many bodies of the saints who had fallen asleep were raised. And coming out of the graves after His resurrection, they went into the holy city and appeared to many. Verse 53. And the graves were opened, and many bodies of the saints who had fallen asleep were raised. Some commentators believe there should probably have been a break between the end of Matthew 51 and the start of Matthew 52. And the reason is because we aren't supposed that the earthquake that happened to split the rocks during the crucifixion also opened the graves of some of the righteous dead who waited in those open graves for 3 days until coming out of the grave after the resurrection of Christ. So if that happened right then the graves would have been open for 3 days before He came out. So it could have been, now I'm not saying that couldn't be possible, but it would make more sense. I'm just mentioning that just in case somebody is, you know, turning his wheels and said, man, you know, it was right here, and then, but the Lord wasn't raised in the tree when they came out. Well, so, but it says, I want to point you to 1 Corinthians 15, or Colossians 1:18. We read there that Jesus is called the firstborn from the dead. What does that mean? He's the firstborn. We know there was people in the Old Testament that have been raised from the dead. Lazarus was raised. That was before Jesus died. So what does it really mean? This is not speaking of the first time that somebody was raised from the dead, but it speaks of preeminence, priority, and uniqueness. Jesus was the unique one because he died without sinning. Thus, death could not hold him. Death can only claim sinners. And it's their decision as they go through life where they're going to end up. If there is a resurrection to the righteous for everlasting life, or the unrighteous, everlasting damnation. So Jesus had to rise in triumph from the grave, having conquered it. And so only Jesus' resurrection gives the guarantee of the resurrection of the righteous and the unrighteous in the day of judgment, and that all who are raised as believers in him will share in his resurrection one day. Some to eternal glory, and again, some to eternal damnation. So all the other examples in the Bible of a resurrected people, notice, they would die again. Christ was the only one who never died again. Even Lazarus would die again. Not so for Jesus. So it appears that these raised right here we're talking about in this verse, these dead saints were resuscitated just like Lazarus in order to die again. So Jesus was truly the first born from the dead, never to die again. Does it make sense? Verse 54. So when the centurion and those with him who were guarding Jesus saw the earthquake and the things that had happened, they feared greatly, saying, truly, this was the Son of God. The scene of the crucifixion of Jesus was so striking that even the most hardened Roman centurion confessed that. This was the Son of God. This man who perhaps had supervised the death of hundreds, the crucifixion of hundreds of other men, knew that there was something absolutely unique about the Lord, about Jesus. This was the Son of God. The only thing wrong is the verb tense. Jesus is the Son of God, not he was the Son of God. The Roman centurion seemed to assume that Jesus was no longer the Son of God because he died. But he is the Son of God. So when you read through that, always keep that in mind. That's why, you know, anytime you see movies or anything and you look into a Catholic cathedral or anything, the Lord's on the cross, the Lord's on the cross. Now the Lord is not on the cross anymore, you know. So we know what you mean by that, but there would be an even more powerful statement to take the Lord off the cross and leave it empty there because he is indeed risen. Verse 55. And many women who followed Jesus from Galilee ministered to him were there looking on from afar. So Jesus not only made an impact upon rough and hardened men like the Roman centurion, but even women like Mary Magdalene, which was the former demon-possessed gal that the Lord cast seven demons out of. Other women followed Jesus as well from Galilee, according to Luke 8:2. So every time I bring the cross reference in, because as you read in Matthew, like I said, always go and cross reference the other four Gospels, because it fills in the gaps or additional information which makes the picture complete. Notice many women, it says there, to their everlasting honor. These women evidenced more courage and affectionate attachment to their Lord and Master than disciples than the disciples who had promised to die with him rather than to forsake him. Speaking of big boy Peter, they were gone. Only John was there. But it was more women than the rest of these guys. Men. Think with me, who was there at the cross? Men and women, Jews and Gentiles, rich and poor, high class, no class, religious, irreligious, guilty and innocent, haters of Jesus and lovers of Jesus, oppressors and oppressed, weepers and mockers, educated and uneducated, the deeply moved and the indifferent, different races, different nationalities, different languages and classes. As one commentator said, that mixed crowd was surely a prophecy. All sorts and conditions of men have been attracted by the cross. Didn't leave anybody out. We read here in verse 55 that one of the women at the cross was the mother of James and John. These are the Zebedee brothers. Do you remember back in Matthew 20? The mother of John and James came to Jesus and asked him, "Hey Lord, can you do me a favor? Could one of my boys be on your right hand and one on your left hand when you get into your kingdom?" And the Lord said to her, "You don't know what you're asking." And I believe as she was standing there looking at the cross, seeing Jesus hanging there with a man hanging to your left and another one hanging to his right, I truly wonder if her heart stopped and realized as she, what she actually asked the Lord, how little she had understood what he meant. Because very likely they could have been her boys. So verse 57, we're moving on. "Now when evening had come, there came a rich man from Arimathea named Joseph, whom himself had also become a disciple of Jesus." I'm reading to all the way through 61. "This man went to Pilate and asked for the body of Jesus. Then Pilate commanded the body to be given to him. When Joseph had taken the body, he wrapped it in clean linen cloth and laid him in his new tomb, which he had hewn out of the rock. And he rolled a large stone against the door of the tomb and departed. And Mary Magdalene was there, and the other Mary sitting opposite the tomb." Under normal circumstances, or customarily, the bodies of a crucified criminal were left on the cross literally to rot or to be eaten by animals. Anything, crows, whatever falls off sooner or later. But we know that the Jews wanted no such horror displayed during the Passover season. On the other hand, the Romans were also known to grant the corpses of executed men to friends and relatives for proper burial. And we know, again, going back into a cross, filling in the gaps, Mark 15:45, that when Joseph of Arimathea came to ask for the body of Jesus from Pilate, that Pilate was astonished that people that Jesus was already dead. He asked him, one of his guys said, "Go check. Is he already dead?" He was perplexed that he died so quickly. So, knowing that, it appears that Joseph of Arimathea was not an everyday John Doe from the street. In order to go to the most powerful individual in the land, who is representing the most powerful empire on the planet, you had to have some kind of clout and influence. So this guy, Joseph Arimathea, wasn't just somebody nobody knew. He had some influence, he had some pull. To approach Pilate for that kind of a favor. Now, in the parallel passage of John 19:38, we read that Joseph of Arimathea was a disciple of Jesus, but secretly. This is actually a mistranslation. It's translated here as an adverb, but the verb in the Greek is actually an adjective. That means it should have read that he was secreted. He was in hiding. He had defended the Lord before the Sanhedrin, as you remember, all the illegal trials that happened at night. So his life was probably at risk. So Joseph of Arimathea was in hiding, and that was another reason that Pilate was astonished. As he came to him, having to come out of hiding in order to get the body. And how do we know that? Because of one little letter that makes basically the difference in the Greek. It makes it an adjective, not an adverb. So he was secreted in fear of the Jews. You might think it's not a big deal, but again, it shows you the precision of the Greek language and also the precision of what God has to say in the way he says it. Now in John 19:39, we read that Joseph of Arimathea was also accompanied by Nicodemus, another teacher, another person that was present at the trials, another person that turned his life over to Christ. Both very influential personalities among the Sanhedrin and the religious leaders, but again, born-again brothers and disciples of the Savior. Now, please keep in mind that these two guys actually were risking everything for Christ. We read over that, not even thinking about anything. But these two guys were risking everything for the Lord. If they were caught, they would have lost their prominent position in the temple and in society. They would have been risking ritual defilement, which meant they would not have been allowed to celebrate Passover. Why? Because after touching the dead body of Jesus, that's it. You have to go through ceremony, cleansing, da-da-da. No Passover for you. But even more extreme, potentially they could have been sentenced to death for siding with this one who was crucified. And on top of that, you might even hear once in a while, here and there, because it's talked about these two guys being secret disciples. They might have been secret disciples, but they came out, they were available when they were needed. What happened to the prominent disciples? Where were they? Nowhere there. Didn't even come out of hiding. What were Peter, James, and John? They were, the scripture says, nowhere to be found. And therefore, it was the secret disciples, Joseph and Nicodemus, who were at the cross ministering to the body of the Lord, of their Lord. There's a little bit of a parallel towards us too, always is. That's how the scripture operates. Where are we today? You and I in our lives, individually, not as couples, whatever, just you and I. Where are we today in our walk with the Lord and in our ministry for his kingdom? Are we nowhere to be found? Or are we starting to wake up, smell the coffee, as they say? And starting to put a space after the W. And instead of nowhere to be found, we're now here to be available. And I believe and hope that we might be able just to demonstrate that whether we walk out of here after the teaching or tomorrow, but very likely after the third or around the third of next week and the days and weeks after that, should the Lord tarry. Are we now here? Are we out there to be seen? Are we the light or nowhere to be found? Pray about that. Verse 59. When Joseph had taken the body, he wrapped it in clean linen cloth. Again, in the parallel passage of John's Gospel, we read that Nicodemus brought a mixture of myrrh and aloes, weighing about 100 pounds. So that shows you that Nicodemus was a very wealthy guy. And we know that there's a lot of people that were very wealthy in history throughout the scripture, from Abraham all the way through. And a lot of people do the right thing with their wealth. They give it right back where it came from. And the Lord just keeps on pouring it on. Joseph and Nicodemus followed the burial customs of that day the best they could, because they had to be in a hurry, considering that they had a very little time left because the Sabbath drew near. Luke tells us this in his account in Luke 23:54. And so in verse 60 then, and laid it, so Joseph took the body, wrapped it in linen cloth, and laid it in his new tomb, which he had hewn out of the rock. And he rolled a large stone against the door of the tomb and departed. And then he laid him in the tomb. I read, something said it, I don't know who. He came into the world from a virgin's womb. He came forth again from a virgin tomb. Because we know from Scripture that nobody ever occupied that tomb before. It was a very fresh, new tomb that nobody had occupied before. Nobody had ever been set in that tomb. So that when the body came forth and the tomb was empty, there was no possible confusion as to which body came forth. Right? I heard that for those people that are maybe familiar with Pastor Chuck Smith from Calvary Chapel, he said there was actually an unrecorded conversation that went on. It's not in the scripture. That's according to Chuck. That's not in the scripture between Pilate and Joseph. So when Joseph came to Pilate to ask for the body, Pilate turned to him and said, wait a minute. You just spend all that money and that time to hew that tomb, your family tomb, out of that rock on your property. And you're going to give it to this criminal? And Joseph of Arimathea turned around and said, no worries. It's only going to be for the weekend. Well, that's not in the scripture. So,
did Joseph end up using that tomb afterwards? Did the tomb get used?
Well, the tomb probably, I don't know. We'll find out in a minute.
Yeah. Was it ever used again?
But I don't think after the Lord was probably in the tomb that Joseph would have used that same tomb. I don't know. But the tomb is still around. It's still open. Mm-hmm. I don't think it was ever closed again. Somebody would have probably written something in history, especially in that area. And we know that a lot of these writings from Josephus and all these people that came afterward, the church fathers, there was a lot of people paying attention, probably. I don't know, but I can't tell you for sure. That's my 5 cents. The door then was sealed with a heavy circular stone running in a groove, and you probably have seen it in pictures or in movies, and that settled down into a channel so it could not be moved, except you had a whole lot of people with a lot of muscle to roll that thing back out of again, because you had to go kind of up against that, you know, where it dropped down, that step. So in John 1842, we read that the tomb of Joseph of Arimathea, where Jesus was laid, was close to the place of actually Jesus' crucifixion. But there was also a garden nearby, which you read in the same passage. It's a 5-minute walk from Golgotha, where Jesus was crucified, to the garden tomb, which most likely is the tomb of Joseph of Arimathea and the tomb where Jesus was buried in. There's next to the garden tomb a 250,000-gallon cistern, which implies that the area belonged to a single owner at one point in time, somebody who had some money. And so it would make sense that a garden tomb was a rich man's tomb carved into the rock, and therefore possibly belonging exactly to Joseph Arimathea. Verse 61, and Mary Magdalene was there, and the other Mary sitting opposite the tomb. On the next day, which followed the day of preparation, the chief priests and the Pharisees gathered together to Pilate, saying, Sir, we remember when he was still alive, how that deceiver said, after 3 days I will rise. Therefore command that the tomb be made secure until the third day, lest his disciples come by night and steal him away and say to the people, he has risen from the dead. So the last deception will be worse than the first. Pilate said to them, you have a guard. Go your way. Make it as secure as you know how. So they went and made the tomb secure, sealing the stone and setting the guard. My, oh my, oh my, the hypocrisy. Hypocrisy in the highest. The next day, it says, they came to Pilate. That means the chief priests and the Pharisees approached Pilate on the Sabbath day. Defiling themselves, breaking the law. But hey, look around. What's going on here? Whether they are governors, mayors, judges. As long as we get our mischievous deeds done, it doesn't matter. We break the law, whatever is necessary. Hypocrisy. Hypocrisy in the highest. For the enemy of God, there are no sacred laws in order to get the evil intentions done. And then they said, we remember. Well, this is ironically because the enemies of Jesus remember his promise of resurrection better than his own disciples did. And they were there with him all the way to the end. But that's what happens sometimes. And that's why when it says in Psalm 1 to meditate on the word night and day, that whenever the heat, you remember the heat, the Lord only allows the heat to be turned up so high because he promised he's not going to give us more than we can handle. But we need often the high heat in order to get purified, to get stronger for what is ahead of us. Because if we are not, if we don't allow the Lord to do that, then we're going to be the one we're going to basically crack when it gets lukewarm We're not even there in the temperature. And then we render ourselves literally useless. Not only, remember, it's never for us. It's always the people that we actually can't reach or have to leave behind or disengage. That's the problem. The Lord can pick us up. But what about the people that He had a plan already for us to be there, to come alongside them? So we want to make sure. Meditate on the Word night and day. While He was still alive, He had the enemies of Jesus admit, basically, that He was dead. Because they said, hey, remember why He was still alive. That means they believe He's dead. They basically did not believe in the swoon theory. You probably heard of the swoon theory. Anybody? Yeah. A conjecture that demised the resurrection, saying Jesus never really died on the cross, but just swooned on the cross and then somehow wonderfully revived in the tomb. So there was a humorous letter to an editor of a Christian magazine that was written and accurately evaluated, basically, the swoon theory. And it's what it says. Dear Eutychus, our preacher said on Easter that Jesus just swooned on the cross and that the disciple nursed Him back to health. What do you think? Sincerely, bewildered. And so I wrote back, dear bewildered, beat your preacher with a cat of nine tails with 39 heavy strokes, nail him to a cross, hang him in the sun for 6 hours, run a spear through his heart, embalm him, put him in an airless tomb for 36 hours, and see what happens. Sincerely, Eutychus. See, the scripture says that all these people out there that don't want to believe, it doesn't matter how many names they have or what you call these professor, doctor, titles before their name, it doesn't matter. At the end, they make a fool out of themselves. It never fails. That's why when you've all seen Ben Stein in that movie, Expelled, at the very end of the movie, you know, he's talking to Dawkins. He says, so now where did we come from? You couldn't have given me an explanation here. You couldn't give me an explanation there. Nothing of these things. And this guy sits in Oxford. And so where we came from, aliens. So see, it's going to get more absurd every time. You disprove it, or you just use the word. Use what the Lord has given us, and they have no space to occupy or to stand on in regards to giving you a plausible answer. They're always going to make a fool out of themselves, and that's why the Bible is full, warning us, sometimes even to get too much engaged with fools, because there comes a point when we truly start throwing our pearls before swine. It doesn't mean we call them swine, but no, because they are so hardened in their heart, they're so blinded. Perhaps their conscience is already seared, as Paul said, with a hot iron. Nothing will get in there. That's why Paul always warned, do not get involved in endless genealogies or these type of discussions when he wrote to Timothy. Just leave them. Pray for them. Let the Lord deal with them. Because again, we got to realize we don't save anybody. We're just the helpers on the road, you know, giving somebody something to drink, showing him where he finds some food, right, and so on. The Lord does the whole conversion issue. But if people continue to wanting to be blind, wanting to be fools, we're not going to change them. The Lord can use us, and he will use us. And sometimes he sends somebody that's a little more technical, if you will, evolved in his knowledge, to somebody who is a technical guy, or somebody who has a little bit more medical knowledge, talking to a doctor. But that's why we always have to pray, that we make sure we just don't go, oh yeah, I gotta go out, I gotta go witness. The Lord commanded me to witness. So you go out to talk to everybody, which it's not a bad thing. But the way we do it, and we might do it in a assembly in a realm where we had no room to be there in the first place because we never prayed about it, and the Lord had no intention to send us there. That's even if you notice, if that is the case where you live, that you have Jehovah Witnesses coming by or Mormons on a regular basis. Pray for that. Don't just go out there and say, hey, guys, what you doing here? You know, and you don't have to invite them in, but talk to them about it. And you realize maybe at one point in time, man, I never prayed about that first. You know, might not even have the power of the Spirit here with me because I wasn't ready myself to talk to these guys. And instead of sowing some seeds, making them asking themselves questions and the stuff they are being indoctrinated with, we might even just, you know, give them a little bit more firepower. They walked away and said, man, this guy's really lost. I need to come back for him because he didn't know what he was talking about. So always make sure we pray and prepare ourselves for any of these encounters because that's important. That's why the Lord got up every morning, way before daylight most of the time, probably 4 o'clock in the morning. Sometimes he prayed all night. Why? Because he wanted to know what was going on. What is it, Father, that you have for me for tomorrow? That's why he was never surprised. That's why he never stumbled. That's why he was never in odds with the Father or in the things that he was doing. He already knew. He was prepared. And so I'm going to leave this here tonight, even though we were so close to the end, but the time, and also there's a little bit more to it. So we pick up the last three verses there next week and start the new chapter 28 for that. Good? All right. So we get home tonight. Seeing what is going on in our nation, once again, remember what Zechariah said. Not by power or by might, but by my Spirit, says the Lord. This fight, what we see out there, that unrest, that is unraveling, is spiritual warfare, nothing else. It will show itself, obviously, in the rioting and the looting and whatever else that comes with it. But it's spiritual warfare. And make no mistake, Satan's troops, you know, when you see how Iran and Russia and China, all these guys are in the scripture, and they're not necessarily in the positive camp. So Satan is literally unleashing everything and anything he can. He's not doing it on Germany or in Finland. Never hear anything about Finland. They must be constantly snowed in up there or something. Never hear anything about, you know, Uruguay or some kind of, you know, unless there is a pandemic down in, parts of Africa, you don't hear anything about them.
Finland went bankrupt because of socialism.
Yeah, well. But what I'm saying is when it comes to the unrest, lately, over the last many, many, many years, it is always us. Mm-hmm. And it's not because we're so wonderful. And I know we will be judged for what the nation has done, allowed to be done. You know, whether it's abortion, pornography, you name it. You know, worshiping so many gods. Definitely the god of greed and wealth and money and power and everything else that comes with it. There will be judgment coming. The question is when. But in the meantime, the Lord always allowed certain people to be the head of the country, to still come alongside Israel, to still reach out for the rest of the world for religious freedom, do help other countries that are so wicked, you know, just kill their people, there's no laws or whatever, and keep people in check. We don't know when that cloud is be lifted. But I believe you see that now is part of this onslaught of demonic forces, and they come in all kind of forms and shapes. And I don't think we have seen anything yet. So before you do anything, pray. So when you walk out that door, that you are equipped, not just with hardware, no, with spiritual software first. And let the Lord walk before us. And I'm saying that because I see these things that are happening, you know, right now in Philadelphia, everywhere. You can make emotional decisions fairly quickly if you are right in the midst of it. But you want to make it in a way that you know without the shadow of a doubt, whatever you did, you're not never going to question yourself. You know, Lord, you put me there. I didn't go out there. I didn't intend whatever. You told me to talk to these people and suddenly whatever happened. So you know without the shadow of a doubt and don't have to doubt yourself for the rest of your life, however long that might be, and then question yourself and then make yourself miserable. It's very important. Plus, remember, there's a lot of people in these crowds. They are just followers. There's only maybe one or a couple of leaders in there. The rest are just followers. There's still hope for them. There's still souls to be saved. There's still good news to be shared. And we don't want to miss that. And just like a preacher standing, like, you know, you have it seen in some of the years down in Coeur d'Alene and preaching, you know, hellfire, you know, you go to hell, whatever. If you don't turn, you burn or whatever. Then that's not going to help. So it has to be something that only can come from the Lord at the right time, in the right way. Yeah.
You know where it's at. I don't know where it's at. Where Paul got put into jail after he was flogged.
Mm-hmm.
And what did he do?
He praised the Lord.
Saying, yeah. The Lord.
Yeah.
So remember that wherever you're at and whatever right. happens to you, you are in God's will where you are at.
Absolutely. Mm-hmm. Unless you pull yourself, and we have that ability, out of the will of God and go on our own because we think, oh, you know, hey, I cut 245s, I got my rocket launcher on my back, hey, just let's go. That would be foolish because those guys might have the same thing or even worse. But if we allow our lives to be lost or to be, let's say, mutilated to a point that we can do the work that the Lord had us actually, you know, the plan for us, created us for to do because of our own free will, then we are cutting ourselves out of a lot of blessings. And so we have to be careful. There's people out there I know that they did things out of their own free will. They thought it was the Lord, but they really never prayed about it. And then they ended up, whether it was in a wheelchair or just psychologically so damaged that they were no good for anything. And so what's the point for that then? That means, go ahead.
So I just read a book, just came out this year. It's called In Prison with ISIS. And it's a true story about a guy that got arrested in Sudan and his time in prison and the mental thing that he went through. He was a worker for VOM, Voice of the Martyrs.
Mm-hmm.
And he went around and documented people that had suffered for their faith.
Yeah.
And the Sudanese country picked him up and put him in prison. And he was, I think, in there 18 months or something, 14 months. But to see, even in his case, he was reminiscing always about wanting to go home. And then God ended up getting a Bible in his hands, and he just immersed himself in that, and it turned him around, and he realized that God had him there for a reason. He went through horrible torture, you know, with the ISIS fighters.
Yeah.
But it was so cool to see that no matter where you're at, God's there with you.
Yeah, and I believe you can take so many things physically because mm-hmm. you're maybe not even, the Lord kind of doesn't put you there a little mentally. It's something that happens to you physically. Mm-hmm. But because if the spirit really kind of overshadows you, he is probably even able to take some of that stuff and you don't even realize it.
Mm-hmm.
You know? And it doesn't, that's why Paul could do what he was doing. That's, beaten, yeah. Back right in again, because the Lord told me, oh, that's what you're going to preach. So I go right back in again. And he did it again and again. And yeah, how can you do that? You would, at one point, the first time you got a good whooping, you'd say, hey, that's about it, Lord, not me. See? But you see, there's something, being in the will of God, that's why the Lord said that you can move mountains. But you got to be in the will of God, and you got to make yourself, prepare yourself through that by spending time with the Lord. And so he said, hey, you haven't seen anything yet. You can do greater things than what you see here. And the disciples did. They went out. They healed sick, right? They cast out demons and all that stuff. But when we start like Peter, when you look, instead you look at the storm, you look at the, you know, the physical that surrounds you instead of the spiritual, we're all going to fall to like a, you know, like a garden chair. So I believe, you know, for this country, and, you know, the way I look at it is, you know, it's just kind of whatever happens, it's just we are rearranging the chairs on the Titanic. That boat is going down sooner or later. But when? In the meantime, there's people hanging onto the rails. There's people want to jump off, taking their lives. See, there's a lot of work to do. And it's not our job to figure out when that might be. Could be tomorrow. It could be 5 years from now. Who knows? But it's on us, those people that are not safe, those people that are right now going straight to hell, they don't know that yet, but that's what they're counting on. At one point in time, is that somebody steps up in all that melee and all that stuff that is going on. You say, man, I never looked at that. I never even considered that.
You know, there's a scripture that sticks in my craw, and it's Genesis 12:3. It says, I will bless those who bless you, and I will curse those, and whoever curses you, I will curse.
Yeah, that's the promise to Abraham.
Yeah. And I think about what Trump has done for Israel.
Yeah.
And I just think about it. I meditate on that.
Yeah, and it's one thing, and pray for Trump. We don't know where he is either. You know, where his heart is, you know. So he might need, and the reason he's probably still standing on 2 feet without a bullet hole in the front of his head is probably because people have been praying.
Yeah.
Not that he's such a wonderful guy or whatever, you know. No. He is probably, he is really trying to do the right thing. But you got to realize, if you put the Bible under your arm, you better know who you're living for, who you're working for.
Mm-hmm.
And then you have no problems. It doesn't matter where you are, where you stand. You can walk into the UN and can say, hey, I'm here because of a testimony of Christ, whatever it is, and that's what I'm doing. I'm doing the right thing, not because of what you tell me what is right. No, what the book tells me what is right. So we need to pray for him and those people that are basically in that whole setting there, whether it's the Congress, the White House, yeah, because that mess, you know, it's unbelievable. And you know what? You can actually look through it and you basically can say, you know, what's the point anymore? You see these cocky guys, you know, from Twitter and Facebook and Google, and they say, hey, you guys, we can shut down anything we want. We can shut you guys down. I'm talking about the government people, and they can. There's so much money behind, and they probably already, who knows how they are, connections are, where they are already. We will never know. And since the government is so basically broken down, they're not even all on the same page. You know, you wonder who's holding all the things together. Yeah, we know who's holding them together. And it's up to us to not necessarily to pray for, Lord, give us another 4 years. No, Lord, we don't care another 4 years or not. What we need to is your will to be done, however that might look in this country tomorrow or after the third. And this will be a test that to each and every one of us and everybody, not just in this country, but all over the place, maybe after the third or the fourth or whatever, towards the weekend, where we stand as Christians. Are we nowhere to be found? Or maybe it's the first time we're really out there, because nobody else is going to be. Nobody else is going to stand against the evil onslaught or the gap. You can't do it from home, but often the Lord leads you right into the battle. Because there's people on the other side which you wouldn't see, which you wouldn't know, which you wouldn't have an opportunity to talk to if you're sitting at home. Okay, so keep that in mind. Father, we thank you for your word again. Thank you, Father, for the power that is in it, Lord. And thank you, Lord, you've given us the full armor of God. Oh, Lord, may we just pound it into our hearts that we have the word, the two-edged sword that divides between soul and spirit. Lord, it is a discerner of the thoughts and intents of the heart. Lord, that can move mountains. And Father, I'm absolutely convinced if we truly believe when the time comes, whatever word we use, that it will turn, that we release the powers of heaven here on earth, Lord, and will do the things that you promised it will do. Lord, I pray for each and every one in this room, Lord, that you would increase our faith in you, Lord. The faith not in us, Lord, but the faith in your faith, Lord. And Father, that you would give us courage and boldness in these last days. Father, you would draw us into your word, Lord, that you would not spend our days endlessly aiming at things that are gonna burn up, Lord, that are gonna be going up in smoke sooner or later. But Father, that we invest in things that will last for eternity. And Father, that we would realize and be reminded again and again and again, we do not want to walk into your heaven with nothing to show for, Lord. We reminded our five crowns that we may receive, Lord, if we live our lives according to your commandments. And Lord, we want to worship you for eternity as we cast our crowns before you. So Lord, help us that we are the ones that are ruling and reigning for eternity and not just serving, Lord. We thank you again, Father. We ask you, Lord, that as we leave this place here, that you keep us safe and sound on our way home. Keep all the unsafe drives and situations away. Father, use us, whether it's in the conversation on the way home, in our prayers tonight or tomorrow morning, in our private devotions, in our prayer closets, and then throughout the days and weeks, should you tarry, Lord, that we are a mighty force to reckon with, Lord, and that we would use the entire arsenal that you have given us, Lord, in the things that are standing before us. Lord, we have no reason to give up one inch, but in fact, you called us conquerors. So let us be conquerors, Lord. Conquerors for the kingdom of heaven, Lord. We thank you and we praise you. And we ask all these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Okay.